presentation of the Lord's resurrection. I would like to spend a few minutes with you talking about a symbol of the resurrection that is the butterfly. In our Christian art tradition, there are two great symbols of Christ's resurrection. One is the egg. The other one is the butterfly. Like many of you, I have several books going at once. You know, when you read them, you read a little this one, a little that one. And one of my favorite authors, because she writes in such a lively way, she doesn't write on Christianity, though she, I believe she's a Christian. She writes on social, moral justice, social justice, and human rights, and the dignity of the human person. Very well, she writes. Her name is Barbara Marks Hubbard. She's about 85 years old, I think. And I was reading in her on human dignity. And she talked about the butterfly as a symbol of how we are trying to move toward a more Christ-like world and the effort that it takes. So she talks about the butterfly, and my wife and I go to Butterfly Land, Butterfly World over on the freeway often because it's such a gentle place. And she says that the butterfly begins, of course, as an egg. And then the little caterpillar inside the egg eats the egg as its first food. It's full of, I suppose, protein and lots of nourishment. And it eats and eats and it grows very fast. Caterpillars grow extremely fast. And then the little caterpillar spins a web around itself and dies. But she said, in that caterpillar are things called imaginal discs. Imaginal discs. They're little cells. And that's the whole butterfly, is inside a caterpillar, in its cells, in its very cells. And that as the caterpillar turns into a kind of soup inside, causing nourishment for the development of that food for the caterpillar, for the butterfly, these imaginal discs contain all the organs, all the legs, everything of that butterfly. Amazing. But when the cocoon opens, the caterpillar is gone. It's been transfigured. And it becomes something beautiful. Something completely different from what it was before. It was earthbound before, wasn't it? It could just crawl around on its belly. But now it flies. What a beautiful symbol of the resurrection of Christ and of our life in Him. Through our baptism and faith, sometimes without baptism, these imaginal discs are in us of transfiguration in Christ. It's in Christ, always in Christ. You stop and think about that, how beautiful a picture that is, that all of this is done for us. How do you get started? How do you get those imaginal discs to start cooking the butterfly? How do you get that done? As Catholics, of course, we're very tempted to do it with moral profession. And moral profession is a wonderful thing. It really is. To meet somebody whose morals are just about perfect is a joy, but sometimes not. Because moral perfection breeds another animal and produces another animal if you're not careful. You have to be, well, more than careful. It produces pride, which releases all of it. Moral perfection always produces pride, without exception. Only in the mother of God did it not, among people like us. We started as a worm and end up as a butterfly. Christ became a caterpillar so that we could become like Christ, butterflies, right? So that transfiguration is everything. It's John the Cross staked his whole life on it. Well, if that's everything, how do you even start it? Jesus said, with a merciful heart. Here, that's it, a merciful heart. And he had so much trouble with the Pharisees because they really wanted to please God. And they really believe that by being morally perfect, they will. And you couldn't please God with moral perfection. You can. But you can please Him if you're not merciful. Because that's what starts the magical discs to transfigure you. This isn't Jesus teaching on what is perfection. Be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Look at the context of that text, and you'll see what Satan and other Christian teachers focus on as mercy is the thing God wants from us more than everything else. Although moral perfection is asked for in the commandments, we need to do that. We need to walk in it. But our eyes should not be on that, because that will produce pride. Sometimes a pride that turns us against the very things we believe in. It's interesting when you stop and think about how that works. I told you one time that Mother Thecla, 6th century Egyptian desert nun abbess, and how she was asked if purity, moral perfection, was the highest virtue. She said, no, I don't think so. Because I have many nuns who have come to approach almost perfect moral perfection. But they're also very prideful about it. Because that's what it breeds in us. You will like that. No, wouldn't me, yes it would. My hand on it. So, mercy never breeds pride. Because it always means you have to give something of yourself every time you're merciful. The Pharisees couldn't see the 2x4 sticking 6 feet out of their eye, which was their lack of mercy. Jesus said so. But they couldn't see the speck, the lack of moral perfection in the eye of a prostitute. When in fact the prostitute may have had a more merciful heart than the perfect Pharisee. Interesting, if you stop and think about it. His big argument with them was always the same. You focus on moral perfection and you're prideful about it to the exclusion of everyone else. Practice mercy without giving up the other. That's what he taught. So, Christ became a bug. That we bugs could become like Christ. Transfigured in Him. That's more than amazing. Wonderful symbol of the resurrection, but also of our daily practice.